Até 10 horas. Viagem. Segunda. And we had said that this was equal to e to the I k eta upon root 2k 1 plus I minus z minus z k. So there are two solutions and we picked one from the Bunch Davis. And return that. C1 is equal to 1, C2 is equal to 0. So the logic for that was that if you take C1 equal to 1, that means you pick this solution, not its conjugate, then at large k, this behaves, this has the correct commutation relation that we expect from plane waves. Now, so once C1 is picked, this is a full solution. So at large k, super horizon. So k eta thing small. So we are talking about waves which are now. Then your sigma. And our solution was actually we wanted to delta phi, which was delta sigma over A, and do that. Delta A and A. What are they in terms of h? So eta was minus 1 upon ah. Right? So eta a would be minus 1 upon h. Right? So this was the definition of conformal time. So if I replace eta a, so eta a here minus 1 upon h. So, this is minus I still. And this will be can see that the fluctuation is proportional to the Hubble constant divided by k to the 3 half in some phase factor. So this is a result which is important, which you just see now. Why? So now we calculate the 0-point fluctuations. So there are these perturbations which are being generated during inflation. And what we want is that we want to calculate what is the zero point energy of these fluctuations. Okay. So the definition of zero point energy is that so you take vacuum state delta phi xt delta phi take it at the same point, phi star phi. And now, so, and these are operators acting on your vacuum state. So you have to write that field as a operator like I had done. So you have to write this as a cubed k 2 pi 3 by 2. Okay. Here, so now we will talk about delta phi as operator. So the delta phi operator has a delta sigma upon k, which is this. So this is basically this operator. So I will call it h upon root 2 k 3 by 2 e to the power minus I k eta e to the power I so I will write it in this way e to the power I k x a k times this I h e to the power minus I k eta root 2 k 3 by 2 plus its summation by here. Means the next term is a dagger times the conjugate of this. So what did I do? So this earlier this mode function now I have taken in the long wavelength limit. And actually now I am writing for delta phi, not delta sigma. That's the difference. So this is the mode function. So I hope you are not confused that this is A and this is okay, I'll write the code. AK dagger minus IH e to the power IK eta upon root 2 K 3 by 2. So you have a AK and a AK dagger term. So now you take this and put that in this expression and evaluate this. Okay. So basically this vacuum state is the one on which the AK and AK annihilates. Okay. So this AK 0 is 0 and A dagger K on this side is 0. So write this as, so if you express this, you will have B cube K upon 2 pi 3 by 2, B cube K prime upon 2 pi 3 by 2, and 0 delta phi. That is that mode function which I had written in detail there. Oh, this is the convention from either way. AK plus delta phi star AK dagger. Sorry. So plus. That delta, this is the delta phi which I have written in detail. Now you use the usual algebra.
So there will be one e to the power I k dot x.
E to the power I k dot x. Yeah. E to the power I k, I think, I guess it will be k plus, no, k minus k prime. Because
minus minus
minus so here what you get is that you when you expand this the terms which have AA will be 0. A dagger will be 0. So you will have two types of term, A dagger and A dagger A. Okay. Use the commutation to convert that into 1 plus A dagger A. okay, a dagger array operating on vacuum is 0, so you will get that term 1, that is your 0-point identity. I hope you know all that from just the basics. I can just look, check that, that will work out. And then integral, which integral gives you, okay, the delta function should give you, now this is the thing, the delta function was giving you, and in between you have to use AK, AK dagger prime was delta cube of K plus K prime. So what will that give you? Yeah, here. So what I wanted to do was, so you have AK, AK prime dagger plus. You have this term, right? So you have to write it as 1 minus one is basically just delta of right. So this is what you should get.
Sir?
Yeah?
Is one of should one of the fields be complex conjugated then?
Yeah. 5 star is what I have put here. So maybe I should not complex conjugate it. That's the
because inside the vacuum there is no.
Yeah, so this is a real field. Okay, so if I do that, then I think I will get that.
Inside you have not really complex conjugate.
Well, it's the same field.
Yes.
It's the Hermitian conjugate. So I think, yeah, I should use the same field. So if I use the same field, then I think this is the right.
Both are plus sign.
Plus sign. Yeah, that is the right. Thank you. Yeah, I'm just using the 2-point fluctuation of a real field. Yeah, that was the. So you then use the fact that k plus k prime is 0 here, okay, and you can remove one of the delta functions, one of the integrals. Okay. So, now what have I done actually? What you will get. What you will get from this is a dagger k, ak plus that, right? So, thank you. Something of this kind.
Mm.
So, one term will be 0.
It's a commutator, yeah? Right? Sign,
what is that?
Sign is k minus k prime, right?
Hmm. No.
On that first step, on the left hand side.
Yeah.
It's a dagger minus a dagger.
So, okay, let me see first let's start again. So, you have this and you what? Huh?
It's in the first one itself. Is it a minus sign in this one?
Well, here. No, here it's a plus sign. That's
the. So, is it a dagger minus a dagger?
No, why should that be?
The commutator.
This
no, this is not a commutator. I am just writing out what you will get from here. Okay. So, what you will get from here is 2a's, 2a daggers, both are 0.
Yes.
And then you get this kind of term.
Yes.
So this kind of term, then I want to turn into something which is a dagger. So I'll just plus delta function of a plus k. We can put the okay.
together. A dagger A plus that. So A dagger A acting on the vacuum is 0. So what you get in the remaining thing is a delta function, and that gives you the 0-point fluctuation. If there was a occupation number, okay, if the vacuum was occupied, then this would give you some the number density of the particles. But we'll start with 0 particle state. So if you write it out, these are the steps you'll see that you have this term, then you use the commutate to put a A here, and then you get a delta function using this. Okay. And the delta function then removes one of the integrals and gives you a, you put this equal to 0. And then basically.
So that is delta Q.
Delta Q. I've jumped so many notations that this is the least of them. Okay. So then this gives you basic d cube k upon 2 pi 3 by 2. So 2 pi cube here now. Delta pi k theta whole square. The delta by k eta is this quantity. And this you can write as dk upon k times k cube, so 2 pi square pi square. And this quantity, this is the notation, this quantity is called the power spectrum. So this is defined as dk upon k, p of k. So what is the meaning of a power spectrum? So you can see what this represents are amplitudinal fluctuations of a given wave number k. Okay. So what this tells you that if you pick a k, what is the size of the fluctuation? So, if you write it in this form, absorb this k cube inside there, okay, then this pk defined as k cube upon 2 pi square delta pi k theta mod square. This represents the fluctuations, the amplitude of amplitude square of fluctuations of wave number k. Now, long time ago, it was recognized so that you should have a pk which generates your structure . So long time ago, from astrophysical observations of structure at different scales, this Zeldovich and Harrison, separately, they concluded that if there is something which is perturbing, there is a primordial perturbation, or the perturbation that they observe in the structures, that is independent of the size of the structure they are observing. Okay. So this basically what they say is delta rho k upon rho. And this is some amplitude square, and this is independent of k. So what does this mean? That you have, you say any density, or you have a, you look at the universe at various k, that means at various sizes, and you find out the fluctuation over the mean. statistically, and what they found out is the fluctuation over the mean is independent of the wavelength. So at all scales they seem to have the same amplitude. Okay. So they expected this scale invariant. So scale invariant power spectrum. So what is the story in inflation? Pk is k cube upon 2 pi square, and what is delta pi square? So what is the power spectrum from inflation? So this is equal to how much? H square by 2k cube, right? So this k cube cancels that, and this is something like h square over 4 pi square. Okay. So this is a scale invariant power spectrum. Now, they did not assume, they looked from observations that what is the fluctuation in the density over the mean density at various sizes, so galaxy size, megaparsec size and bigger size, and then they said that the delta rho upon rho, okay, the density fluctuation is independent of the size of what they have observed. And inflation then gave that result, which actually says that you get that power spectrum which was predicted by, or which was expected, or what was desired by, from observations. So this whole thing about this Bunch Davis, etc., goes into this k by 3 half, which cancels that k by k.
Is it at horizon crossing or super horizon?
Okay, I'll come to that. So this is throughout now. But what? Where do you calculate the amplitude? Now at this point, you say that h is a constant here. At the lowest level of approximation, h was a constant. So it doesn't matter where, it's the value of h. Amplitude is just the value of h. Okay, it is a constant. But as you asked, that h is actually not a constant because the field is rolling down. When it rolls down, h changes slightly. So where the field was, okay, so at a k value, at the time when a particular k crossed, is what matters. So then I'll come to that how you take that into account. So, and that builds a small k dependence into this. Because h is actually k dependent.
Are working with super horizon approximation.
Yeah.
So that means it is at the time of
super horizon means all k whose physical wavelength is longer than the h inverse. So I am talking about the entire spectrum of k. So there is not only one k.
So does that mean you are considering this perturbation only at the time of horizon crossing?
Yes. This is perturbation at the time of horizon crossing, and I'll come to a few results that basically the amplitude remains constant once it crosses the horizon. So that is another result. So that is why the amplitude when it crosses the horizon, whatever its value is, it's frozen, and then that comes back. Okay, so, but as I said, today I'm just going to give you the results because.
So these super horizon modes, we don't really observe the super horizon modes, right? We observe the sub horizon modes.
We, well, when I am saying super horizon, super horizon at the time of inflation. Okay. So they have to be super horizon at the time of inflation. That means they should go out of the inflation horizon. Then they come back to our horizon now. Now they are sub horizon for our horizon. So in this calculation when I was talking about, when I said super horizon, it is outside the H inverse, the H beam.
Where these super horizon modes are now sub horizon for us, it's not the entire observable universe, it's some finite area.
Yeah.
Like after some distance, the modes are sub horizon. Those that were super horizon, they only cover some region up to our horizon. Right, not all the modes that you observed were super horizons back then.
Yes, actually we have the modes which have come in early, okay, they are now sub horizon because our horizon is expanding. Okay, so there are all modes, all values of k from very small values to horizon size values. So 1 megaparsec to 1000 megaparsec, we have all k. So the ones which are small are the ones which came in first and the horizon has now expanded. Okay, so now I'll give you an important step without proof, which, and this takes a long time, not a long time, but a little algebra to do. So, but one more important thing I should point out here is, well, this whole thing told you that all delta phi, is proportional to your h. Okay, so these are the 0 point fluctuations. And this is proportional to h on, okay. So the value is, the amplitude is h during inflection. Now in this is true not just for the inflaton, I just use a free field equation. So this is true for all fields. Even if they were not present in the time of inflation, okay, their fluctuations were present. So if there is a field in the universe, okay, you got created a field, a thought of a field, its 0 point fluctuation is there at the time of inflation, even if that field doesn't exist. Okay. So one of the consequences of that is that,
Do these super horizon modes give anything from the base minimum 64 to some higher number? No, this number 64 came that you observe what is the smallest size fluctuation and what is the horizon, and for that whole thing to come in,
it should be 60 e-foldings. Because at least 60 e-foldings of them should go out and come in. There could be more which are still outside the horizon. So 60 is the minimum number for inflation. And the actual inflation could be any number which is much larger. But there is no limit on, no observable limit. So as I was saying, this 0 point fluctuation exists for all fields. Although in the this inflation papers we normally talk about the inflaton 0 point fluctuation. Why? Because the inflaton has a dominant energy density potential. So if there is a delta rho, so there is a V phi which is rho. Okay, that is the biggest rho. And delta phi, delta rho will be V prime phi delta phi. So the largest density fluctuation occurs for inflaton or the field which has that potential. If the field doesn't have a potential, it doesn't have a density, there is no density fluctuation. So there is a small density fluctuation. Now over zero. Now this, so now let me change to another subject. let's talk about the Higgs. So the Higgs has a peculiar property that you know that Higgs potential is of the form minus mu square
h square plus lambda h to the fourth.
So this structure is so you see that at large, so this is V H upon H. So at large H, this is basically of the form lambda H to the 4, asymptotically. When H is large, then this term dominates. Okay. Now this lambda is a quantity.
Large means how large?
Large compared to the, when H is large compared to V. The vacuum expectation value, that is 246 GeV, and that V is determined by this mu. Okay. So, well, it is known that lambda renormalizes. Okay. So, at large values of field, the lambda will change. Okay. And the lambda has this peculiar property that lambda actually becomes negative. Add something like 10 to the field values or energy scale, which is 10 to the 11 GeV. Okay. So renormalization changes lambda to make it negative. And so the thing to remember here is what is called the renormalization scale. When you're plotting the effective potential is the value of the field. Okay, when you're plotting the potential, lambda, as all of you know, is some renormalization scale, which is the energy density of the experiment. But for the effective potential, that mu is actually the value of the field. So, what happens to the, if you take into account the renormalization of lambda, what would this potential look like? This would look like, it becomes positive, but at some point, at 10 to the 11, okay, the Higgs potential becomes negative because lambda becomes negative. Okay, so I have drawn too many plots here. So lambda goes like that and becomes negative, so this is 0. And at electroweak value, at pi equal to 100 GeV, the value is of lambda is 0.13, and that is related to the mass of the Higgs, which is 125 GeV. Although okay, so this is 10 to the 11 GeV. So at 10 to the 11 GeV, this potential, Higgs potential, will become negative, and then it's unbounded negative. So what happens is that now you see, so people said and people have worked out that we are here, V equal to 246 GeV, and you say, well, we are here and at large lambda, this Higgs becomes negative, and people have worked out the tunneling time from here to there, and the tunneling time is of larger than the age of the universe. Yes. So that calculation says that, okay, even if Higgs potential becomes negative, there is no problem because we are, the tunneling time is larger than the age of the universe. So we are in a metastable vacuum. Not a stable vacuum, but the stability is longer than the lifetime of the universe. Okay. So as far as the Higgs potential now is concerned, this issue of lambda becoming negative is not a problem. But if you talk about inflation, there is a problem, and this is all. For inflation, you have a potential. Yeah.
In the second, I mean, beyond this second maximum.
Yeah.
There is no vacuum.
What do you mean? Well, vacuum. So what happens is that some point in the universe, the Higgs has some value, okay, and it rolls down, and now it has a vacuum here.
Yes.
Okay. After that, there is no vacuum. It will start rolling down. So what will happen is the universe will have start negative and negative values, and that is sort of is undefined what it really means. Okay. So there is a instability here. Now let's plot the line. That is the inflaton, which I said was like that. And this is a large scale, so V14 was 10 to the 16 G. So let's plot one. So this is at the gut scale, okay. But let's say we plot this Higgs. Okay. So there is a Higgs potential, which is like that.
Sir?
Yeah.
So the equation you have written about V A that says that at H equal to 0, V should be 0.
What or not?
So at the minus mu square H square plus lambda H to the power 4.
Yeah.
At H equal to 0, it is coming out to be 0. Right?
H is equal to what?
0.
What is coming out to be 0?
V H.
So lambda H to the power 4 is only at high H values.
Okay.
This is at high H, so that is the whole thing. And this is why it is 0, no?
Yes, it is 0.
The potential is that 0 right now. So when at high values of H, the V actually, the universe is here right now. But if H was a larger value, then the lambda term dominates. Okay, and then when lambda becomes negative at high values, then V becomes negative. What?
We have
Pi square theory has only one, pi four theory has only one minimum. So supposing a pi four theory, it has only one minimum.
This is symmetric, right?
Yeah.
Not symmetric.
So what I am saying is that the symmetry breaking is very minor.
It's zero at zero.
Like that.
Okay.
This is what the potential looks like. So symmetry breaking is happening at the 100 GeV scale. If you go to 10 to the, so think of mu as some parameter which is 100 GeV. So when you are talking about pi of 10 to the 11 GeV, that mu term is negligible. So then, so this is the potential and basically it looks like that, lambda pi to the 4. And at high phi, the lambda becomes negative, so this becomes like that.
Sir, I have one confusion.
Yeah.
Sir, I mean, you were saying that high H,
yeah,
the dominant term in the potential is lambda H to the power 4. Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
So, any other term is there?
There are lots of terms. Yeah. There are lots of terms, but if you just take this term.
I'm saying so because at high H, it can never be 0 again if lambda H to the power 4 is the dominant term. Because
it has to be 0.
So there would be some mass terms.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. So there will be some terms which.
No, but lambda is changing.
Why you require
lambda is. Okay, so what you should do is the following. So what is plotted? VH is lambda H times H4. Okay. So lambda is not a constant.
Lambda
is a changing function of H.
Okay.
So this whole thing, I've shown you what is lambda as a function of H.
Okay.
So when you plot this, then it looks like this.
You are saying at that point, lambda becomes 0.
Yeah, lambda becomes 0, exactly. And then lambda becomes negative from that point.
Okay.
Lambda
so
is actually a function of mu. Mu is the
mu is the H. Lambda is a function of mu and mu is H for the effective theory.
Okay.
Alright, so what I was saying was the phi rolls here, from here to here. Okay, and you have all the good stuff of inflation, and there is a little Higgs potential which is not doing much. But as I said, at some point, all the because of the vacuum fluctuations, supposing the Higgs constant and gave you the Higgs field and chose your vacuum of 246 GeV, okay, because of the quantum fluctuations, 0 point fluctuations of the de Sitter space, all fields would acquire a value H. Okay. And H, as I said, is something like 10 to the 13 GeV. Why? Because you can write V you know, H is 8 pi g by 3 V. And V you put 10 to the 16 GeV, you will get H to be something like this. So the value of the Higgs field is actually 10 to the 13 GeV.
Due to quantum fluctuation.
So the Higgs field is somewhere here. At the unstable point of the Higgs potential during inflection. So, as I said, the right now we are, okay, you look at this picture. This is the electroweak vacuum where V is 0, the value of H is 0. And I said to tunnel from here to here, it takes a long time. So there is no problem. But during inflation, I said that all fields, H, the quantum expectation value, H square, is H square. That was the previous calculation. 0 point fluctuation of all field is proportional to the H, the Hubble scale. Okay. So, the Higgs field also has the same, just like the inflaton field. Okay, all fields have a value which is the H. But it doesn't matter for other fields. Okay, there is a small fluctuation. For the inflaton, it is important because this is the cause of the density fluctuation because there is a dominant density. But if the Higgs field is here, it will start rolling down in the negative direction. Okay. What happens then? You have the total potential now, the inflaton potential plus the Higgs potential. Higgs potential is now starting to be large and negative. So this destabilizes inflaton. Okay.
But if somehow we can make mass of the Higgs greater than Hubble, then it will not shift.
It will not?
It will not shift towards this.
Yeah, but you see everything is in the potential. I mean, once you know this is the potential,
yes,
then you cannot play with any mass of the Higgs or anything. It's all there in the potential. Second derivative of the potential is the mass.
So if Higgs mass is phi dependent, I mean inflaton dependent.
Yeah, yeah. So then you have to do a lot of other things.
Yes.
So to solve this problem, you can do anything. It's open problem. You can.
Then also H will be there.
No, then H will not be there. If there is no inflation, H is here.
No, because
H will be there, but
H
it should be small.
Very small. If the field ever acquires H to the 11 GeV. So you say that the universe was never at a temperature of 10 to the 11 GeV. So you say that when the universe early years to now, the Higgs was always in the stable region. Okay, so you can solve the problem if you do not have the inflation by saying that Higgs was never at the unstable region. But if you have inflation, you cannot help it because 0 point fluctuation will put it here and it start rolling down. So there are many solutions, but it's open. So I would say it's open. So you can look it up. Okay, so let me quickly get to what we actually measure in the CMB is what is called the curvature. Now this is going to be and the curvature is okay, I'll skip a few steps and I'll just say this is equal to H upon pi dot delta pi. Okay. So what you measure is not the delta pi, but H times delta rho by rho, which is delta. So this is actually H times delta rho by rho, and delta rho is what I have written there. So here you use the fact that delta rho for the V is V prime delta phi and delta rho by rho dot is H. And rho dot is 3H T plus rho, which is 3H phi dot, and you get that. Phi dot is rho
minus
plus T is
minus.
No,
minus 3H.
This is minus. So all those things If you use, you will get this relation. So what you measure is not just the fluctuation of the field, but this entire quantity. And the second result is R naught is equal to 0 for after modes leave horizon. So this is the quantity which is a curvature which the CMB measures. Okay. And this curvature after the mode leave horizon, this does not change. So it is frozen, curvature gets frozen with delta phi, and these things get frozen when the mode leave horizon. Okay. So the power spectrum of this PR, this I the usual definition k cube upon 2 pi square. Delta r square is k cube upon 2 pi square, h square upon pi dot square, and then delta phi square. And this delta phi, as you have calculated before, is so the power spectrum of your curvature is also scale invariant, right? Because this pi has a k cube, and that k cube cancels that. So this k cube cancels this k cube. So the power spectrum of the curvature is scale invariant, which means that this is actually the special curvature. This is the curvature of the free space. So this is power spectrum of R is scale invariant. And this is what is seen. And so now this scale invariant, exact scale invariance was due to the fact that you have assumed h, phi, and all these things. Basically, so when it rolls down, okay, e phi upon phi. So when the field is rolling, V changes. If V changes, H changes, and phi dot and phi double dot, they also change. They are all depending, they depend upon where the field is. Okay. So all these quantities depend upon the slope of the potential. So if the potential is not flat, exactly flat, then because so basically what happens is this, one mode leaves, okay, and this leaves the horizon, and so let us say at some point you have some mode is leaving. Okay, so this mode is value k now. So this is, and this mode is of the size k now. So why am I drawing? If it is k, why did it become bigger? Because what I am showing you is the physical wavelength. And what I have denoted k is your co-moving wavelength. Okay, so that is a nice thing that you can identify what is here from what left by looking at the co-moving So, and I think this is a k physical is k upon k, which is h. So during inflation, this is k physical is k upon k. AI and this is HI. Yes, that's the time of inflation. Now these modes have grown, okay. And now the K upon A naught is H naught, which means that K physical is during inflation. And k physical now is h naught a naught, where a, h naught a naught is the values now. And what? Am I making a mistake here? Oh, sorry, wait a second. K is a k, okay, yeah, that's correct. Why? Yeah, so lambda physical is a times lambda. Okay. So k physical will be 1 by k lambda, which is k upon.
Then
how k physical during inflation is h and h?
It's just h and h. But
from what you said. Okay. And k physical now is h0. That means the wavelength is h0 inverse.
Thank you.
So these two things together, and this was also k upon a0. Look, it's the same k. So these two together tell you that for an inflationary mode to have left the horizon and re-enter our horizon now, okay, K I H I should be equal to K naught H naught. Oh, sorry. K I H I is K naught H naught. And that actually tells you, what does this teach you? No, not scaling invariance. What information does this give you? I hope I. No, you think of a practical benefit of this, not a practical, I mean, what you learn from this, what information does this tell you? Hi is, as I said, 10 to the 13 GeV. Okay. H naught we know. It is 10 to the minus 42 GeV. Okay. Which is that 100 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Okay. So that if you know this H, you know the ratio between A during inflation and A now. So that tells you how many e-foldings inflation has to occur. Okay. So this will give you, so you can look it up, and this gives you that e to the n is 10 to the 29, or n is something like 50. Okay. So it's very simple to work these things out, you can do it.
So this a naught is the value of the scale factor at the end of the inflation.
During inflation, because
A naught
is the, well, this is now, values now.
And and then AI is
AI is during inflation when a particular K mode left.
When a particular K mode left.
Yeah. Okay. If that K mode comes in. So this gives you what is the expansion factor. And okay, I can finish. So now I will derive with this. I hope this was got. This is actually simple. Did everybody get this or no? No.
How do we know H during inflation, the value?
Well, this is what I will come to in the end, that the perturbation, the amplitude of the perturbation is what is measured in the CMB. And the amplitude of the perturbation depends upon potential and some slow roll, and the spectral index depends upon the slow roll. So working out from there, you can find out that the scale of V is 10 to the 16 GeV, and from V you can work out H using the incident scale. So that's how you know.
But sir, number of E coordinates is the time limit between the beginning and end of the inflation and in the log of that expansion of that.
No, what this means is that for a particular mode, if it leaves the horizon at some particular time, when AI and H is equal to HI, okay, these are the values, and that mode re-enters the horizon now, okay, then this should be the relation between A and H.
No, what he is saying, I think this 60-fold is beginning of inflation and end of inflation. Is this so?
No.
It is from today.
It is from today. How do you convert AI by A naught to E power N?
So AI upon AI upon A naught to E to the power N. Okay,
no,
leave
no.
it as a.
No, no, AI by AF.
AF.
Cannot be AF.
From here to there. That's what
you want this, no?
No, no.
Then?
AI by AF. AF is the scale factor at the end of inflation.
That is E
power. That
is
E
power.
How?
Oh, okay, so let's do this.
Actually, we did that in the tutorial, I don't know.
So what we have said was that this CL measurement, okay, this is L, okay, the modes which went in the end came back early, okay, came back first, okay, so those which came back first at the smallest perturbation, because after that the horizon has expanded. So this is the mode which is end of inflation.
That is also not right, because
the mode which left the horizon early,
yeah,
that should re-enter later.
That should re-enter first, because, oh sorry, no, what I am saying, the mode is left last at the first. Okay, so this is the end of inflation. The modes which left last enter horizon first, and they are the smallest modes. Okay, so it is this one. From this to this point. Okay.
No, that is not right. From that to that is only 10 e-foldings. We are observing only window of 10
e-foldings. No. So okay, one should not plot it on the this thing. This is L equal to, let's say, 1000.
Yeah.
Then there is something in the structure which you don't observe.
Yeah, including
so
that is
whatever structure. Is the structure.
Yeah.
So this is the, so let us say CMB
what
is this
CMB
much.
We are seeing is just a 10.
And there is something more which you don't see in CMB, but there is a perturbator, let's say. And what you observe is end of inflation. So this part you don't actually see in CMB, but you see in the large scale structure.
Okay.
So there is whatever it is that end of inflation is the smallest scale observable by whichever means. Okay. What we see the largest scale from here to here is, this is 60. Okay. Because you know what is the K here, what is the K here. So the K end and K here, the E to the N of that, the N value is 60. Okay. So what we have here is 60, which means that let me, in the inflation picture, let me draw it like that. So here, this is end. Whatever was the mode which left here, is this one. Okay. You go back 60 e-fold. Whatever is the value of phi 60 is what is phi 60, and this is phi n. And then all the other modes. Okay, so let us say this is phi beginning. All the other modes, okay, which are bigger than phi 60, which are bigger than our
horizon,
they are yet to enter the. So they are here. So they are not yet inside the horizon.
I want to make a comment.
Yeah.
As far as I remember, when you do the n calculation, number of each calculation, we do an integral like integral v by v prime by phi v d phi. Okay. So we take the limit as phi n to phi star, not phi beginning. Phi star is the when the mode leaving the horizon.
What is it? N is phi. The minimum number is
yes.
Phi n. So what you do is calculate epsilon equal to 1, calculate the value of phi, which gives you epsilon equal to 1. Okay. That gives you this point, and then you calculate the number n. So that integral n is h dt, which is d phi by phi dot, which is basically d phi upon 3 v prime by so you calculate this integral.
Yes.
Okay.
So what is the limit?
So you say phi n is this. Okay. Phi n.
Yes.
And phi 60, the minimum e-folding. This should be 60. So what you calculate is this, from this to this, there should be 60 e-folding.
That
is
the minimum.
So you count
from the end. You count from the end.
Yes.
The e-folds you count from the end. So from end, that should be 60.
Yeah.
But beyond 60, there can be many.
So
more
there are many
which
have
not
yet
come. So from the end, you have to count 60 e-foldings, and that is what. Those are the modes which are inside the horizon today.
Okay. So Bhavesh was asking, how do you actually calculate from this that n equal to 60, right? So let us say I is equal to the at the time some mode was leaving. Okay, that's the phi 60 was leaving. This was the size at the inflation time. Okay. After that, it has e to the n e foldings during inflation. Then there is this a. There is a reheating error which takes place. Okay. This is A reheat upon A now. That should be equal to
H
naught upon H n. Right? So now, no, this is not correct.
A
you
will be there.
A naught, A naught upon H I.
No, A naught upon H I.
This is a different thing. So this is the expansion during inflation. This is the expansion from the radiation to the matter era and matter era to now. So that is the total expansion during that time. That has to be also included. So that should give you your A now, A zero now, right? A now, right? I can bring too many notations. A now. Okay. Now, what do you do? You already have AI upon A now is H0 upon HI. Okay. T reheat upon T now, T after that goes as 1 by E. So this is roughly it going as 1 upon T. Okay. So this is T reheat upon here now should be T gamma now upon actually G star T gamma now upon G star. T, no, T reheat. So then depending upon what you put in for T heat, you can calculate N from here. Okay. Alright, so let me finish this inflation story now. So, okay, I had some derivation, but I think I'll tell you the main result and so we were saying that this is the power spectrum and this is scale invariant if you don't take into account the fact that H and phi are changing when a particular k value. So what do you do when you so, the actual power spectrum, PR, is written as some AR square times K divided by some notional NR minus 1, or scalar minus 1, NS minus 1, where NS is very close to 1. Okay, that's the notation. So, there is a small change in small dependence upon k of this PR. So how do you take into account that this thing? I'll write it down fast without explanation so that you can look it up. You can do it later. So PR, we have said, is 1 upon 4 pi square h to the 4 times pi dot square. And that's also equal to, if you work the relation for this thing, this is also equal to four pi upon epsilon n pi square 1 upon epsilon okay. So by using this phi dot in terms of V prime and writing epsilon as a from V prime, you can go from here to there. But now let me, so how do I get the scale dependence here? So the way to trick to get the scale dependence in a quick way is as follows. Your NR minus 1 is D log PR divided by D log k, right? Correct? So if I find out the k dependence in PR, I can calculate the NR. That's what it is. So how do I find out the k dependence in PR? I have to find out what is the k dependence of H, phi, phi dot. What does it mean by k dependence of H? What you look at a particular k, okay, and you want to know what is the value of H at which AK HK is K naught H naught. Okay, or sorry. NS minus 1. NS minus 1. So this is the central relation that AK and HK change such that this K, one particular K that you are interested in. Okay. This is the relation between the A at that point and the H at that point when a particular K leaves. I have? This algebra is simple, but so I will do it very quickly. But so nr minus 1, which is d log pr upon d log k, is d log hk to the power 4 upon d log k minus d log phi k dot square divided by d log k from writing the expression from tr, right? The first expression, not the second one. Okay. Okay, you check this later. This. So first I will calculate this d log hk to the power 4 d log k. This is equal to 4 log h and by d log h by d t times dt upon d log h times so there is a k subscript in everything but I'm there. D log k. And this value is 4 h dot by a. This one you should tell me.
So that is del log h.
Del log?
Del t by del log
h. A,
not h. That is a. Oh, I'm sorry. It is dt by del log a. Okay.
What happened?
Is that okay now?
Yeah.
So del log h upon del t is 1 upon del h by del t. That is h dot by h. And this 4 was, okay. Because this 4 was there, that 4 I took out.
What is
this? This you should tell me.
1 by h.
1 by h. Very nice. Okay. 1 by h. And the third vector? How much is the last factor? 1. Okay. Work it out. So that's correct. That's 1. So that comes from there. Okay. And h dot by h with. So this is h. And h dot by h square is minus 2 epsilon. The h dot is related to b prime. So this comes from
minus epsilon, not 2 epsilon.
H dot by h square is minus epsilon.
Epsilon is minus
h dot
by h square. That's the basic definition of epsilon.
Well, there are two things. One is the epsilon defined through v, and the one is through h.
But those are actually basically equal. Eta will differ. Eta from h and eta from v would differ, but eta, epsilon from h and v should not differ.
I mean, you're right. So this is actually epsilon. No, thank you. Yeah, this is epsilon. So this gives me minus 4 epsilon. Okay. Yeah, thank you. The other factor was so now I'll calculate the other part. So del log phi dot star upon del log k, that's 2 del log pi dot upon del log p
del t or del log
p. Del t upon del log a and del log a upon del log k, the usual thing. This is 2 pi double dot by pi dot. Okay. Times 1 upon h times 1. And this quantity is pi double dot by phi by phi dot. This, if you work out in terms of the slow roll, is 2 epsilon minus 2. I think I should have a 1 by h here. This one. Okay. It has to be that. That is. Okay. So, in the end, what do you get for nr minus 1? If you put those two together? Lost a sign somewhere? Yes. I lost a sign.
No, you didn't, because the second term comes with a minus sign.
Yeah, that second term comes with a minus sign.
So that will give you.
But the first term, then I should have put with a plus sign, no?
1 minus sign?
No, it is 2 eta minus 6 epsilon.
So this is 2 eta minus 6 epsilon. Okay. So the final result is that after all this, I went through this part, but it's simple. Your PR, the power spectrum, is AR square K upon some reference K. Reference K means the K where you measure this AR amplitude. Okay. That is something NR minus 1. So the point is that at some sub value, you take a K which is equal to K naught and measure the amplitude. And for the other K values, you use this formula. And NR minus 1 is this. And AR is also in h square upon epsilon. So the results from Planck are that AR is 3.1 plus minus 0.03 times 10 to the minus 10, and NR minus 1 is 0.968 plus minus 0.006. Okay. So, given this, you can take a potential and beat it to that. You take V equal to lambda phi to the 4. Okay. And I think I have a minute to tell you that if you calculate, there is also a tensor perturbation, there is a gravitational wave. Okay, so it's not just the scalar mode, there are tensor modes also. And a similar calculation what I did for the scalar the tensor mode is proportional to h square. Okay, so this is basically measuring the V. And if you take this quantity R, which is PT upon P curvature, this is 16 epsilon.
It's not PT, but AT by AR. It's just amplitude.
No, it's amplitude square. Yesterday I was checking.
Yeah, yeah, but the K dependence should not be there.
Yeah, there is.
So AT square by AR square.
AT square by AR square, which is PT upon PR without dropping the K dependence. The K dependence is anyway N. So basically, this is without the K dependence. You can put the k dependence is k to the power 10 to the minus 2, so that's not there. So this is 16 epsilon, okay? And this is 0.7 from this bicep.
No, sir, for Planck.
Bicep plus Planck plus, okay. So this is the last result from everything.
At 1 sigma.
Huh?
1 sigma.
1 sigma. This is upper bound now. Okay. So this measures the V. Okay. So these are all the numbers. So now you can work out all the things. So let me tell you what is the main result. You have this standard potentials in particle physics. This one used to work with lambda 10 to the minus 12. And this one used to work with M of the order of 10 to the 13 GeV. But both of these give you R, which is something 0.7 or not, which is something like, so this gives you much more than 0.1, this gives you something like 0.9. So both are ruled out. Both give large values of R compared to what is the upper bound. So the common sense potentials are all ruled out. So you can work out the new type of potentials. And so I have covered the part where connecting this particle physics potential to inflation observables, but I went a little slow. So this, how this CMB is measured, I have not covered, but you have to read it up now. Yes.
So it will have how to, you know, connect
the CMB and all that. Actually, all the BWMAP papers were not wrong in the sense that they were, I mean, only the numbers are different.
Yeah,
but the calculations of Bertschinger and there are many papers. So I follow, one is Ryoto lectures. Yeah, so if you want to read this further, this is Ryoto lectures. Yeah. And then there is a Bowman lecture. So you can read further here. So the steps I skipped was defining that PR. Okay, I said curvature was that, why it should be like that. Okay. And also then connection of this curvature to the CMB, how this is better. But there was no time, so you have to read that.
So if you want, I can take a half an hour tutorial and do the tensor perturbations, but
yes,
if you are willing to,
yes.
Yeah.
Then from 2 to 2.30, this room would be available.
I think this room
should
be available. I'll just check with the, in the TV, in the house. I think it should be available.
So then probably from 2 to 2.30, I'll just do the tensor perturbations. Okay. I'll show how to calculate.
So you had a question or? Okay. Okay.